Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Raven's Witness, The Alaska Life of Richard K. Nelson, by Hank Lentfer. Foreword by Barry Lopez. Narrated by Basil Sands. We're here for a little window, and to use that time to catch and share shards of light and laughter and grace seems to me the great story. Brian Doyle. Foreword. It seems appropriate for me to reflect first on the undistinguished chair I'm sitting in as I try to put together a few words to introduce you to this biography of Richard Nelson. I bought the chair long ago in a second-hand store in Springfield, Oregon. I've had to repair it occasionally to ensure its sturdiness. Two worn-out seat cushions, one atop the other, make it easier to occupy for hours at a time. Two newel posts brace a tapered backrest of wooden spindles. The caps of the newel posts gleam from the rub of human hands over the decades. I've written 17 books sitting in this chair, and I hope to complete a couple more in the years ahead. In the early 1980s, because I sensed that resting my back against a pair of cured black-tailed deer hides from Richard's hunts would put me in a more respectful frame of mind when I wrote, and that they might induce in me the proper perspectives about life, I wrote him and asked for his help. Would he honor our friendship by sending me a couple of hides? These were from black-tailed deer he'd hunted in the woods near his home. The way he understood these fatal encounters, as a subsistence hunter trained by indigenous Koyokon people, he'd been given these deer. In my experience, no other non-native hunter's ethical approach to this archetypal encounter with a wild animal was as honorable as Richard's. He hunted to feed his family, imitating the way his Inupiaq, Koyokon, and Gwich'in teachers had taught him to, through the example of their own behavior and engagements with wild animals, honoring, humble, and grateful. I felt the hides might care for me as I stumbled my way through life, in the same way that our friendship with each other would take care of both of us in the years ahead. So this morning I am sitting in front of my old typewriter with my back against those soft hides, and I want to say a few things about this book in which Hank Lentfer introduces us to this extraordinary man, Richard K. Nelson, most of whose friends called him simply Nels. I think of him as remarkable among Western anthropologists who have apprenticed themselves to traditional people because, as a young man, he took on, with fierce dedication and discouraging circumstances, a journey few people have ever had the opportunity to experience. And he pursued that journey with great attentiveness and care for more than 50 years. He listened to his teachers, immersed himself in their landscapes as a naturalist, and became, without intending to, a great teacher himself. What Nels modeled was a way of knowing the world, an epistemology different from the one most of us have unconsciously accepted and sworn ourselves to. It led him to reconsider what in his own life was to be valued over the manic accumulation of material wealth, or progress for the sake of progress, or the exceptional status of humans among all other beings. You'll hear in Hank's thoroughly researched chapters about a man who dedicated himself to an unending personal task, self-education, and who became, because of that, to use Lentfer's unusual but apt term, a kind of monk. He didn't pursue life alone in a cave, staying out of touch with others and with the physical world, but became instead a carrier of wisdom from traditions he had known nothing about as a young university student. This is to say, the wisdom of marginalized and vanishing hunter-gatherer cultures in remote parts of North America. He came to understand, through decades of intimacy, applied study, and life practice, a frame of mind he was once innocent of, one based much more firmly on enduring human values like thinking morally and ethically about wild animals. As he wrote about this perspective in books and articles, and as he began to speak publicly about other ways of knowing, he developed the aura of a person shaped by something on the far side of pedestrian reality. A monk, then. A key to understanding these chapters is to recognize how often illumination came to Richard in the company of other people. To see the social dimension of the wisdom he offered to share with us. Over time, Nels slowly became someone more intent on listening than in advancing himself as a speaker. Inupiaq people in the 1960s saw that this outlander from Wisconsin was willing to listen attentively and to work hard in order to acquire knowledge and field skills. By the time he arrived among the Koyokon and Huslia and Hughes in the 70s, he had learned to present himself as quintessentially a listener, not a cultural anthropologist. As a result, the breadth of his learning widened and deepened. By the time he was camping in Glacier Bay with Hank Lentfer in 2016, he was listening to the world around him so closely he could differentiate between the seemingly identical songs of two fox sparrows calling from the same thicket. He could tell from the anxious behavior of a gray whale in a protected bay on Kruzoff Island that orcas were swimming nearby, unseen. He understood that his professional position in life had moved beyond anthropology, good as he was at that, to a level of attentiveness to the non-human world that one of his Koyokon teachers, Levine Williams, alluded to when he informed Nels one day in Hughes that every animal knows way more than you do. The truth of Levine's remark was both metaphorical and factual. To be patient, to pay attention to the world that is not you, is the first step in the neophyte's discovery of the larger world outside the self, the landscape in which wisdom itself abides. Other residents of the world, Levine was telling Nels, know more than we do about how to survive whatever is coming. Their investment is not in progress, but in stability. Nels's life became the passing on of this deceptively simple message about human survival. It was this message that he lived. Barry Lopez, Finn Rock, Oregon, November 2019. Prologue. Solid Ground. My earliest memories are frozen on the Chukchi Sea. A bowhead whale had been killed, and my family, like everyone else in Utqiagvik, traveled to the ice edge to lend a hand. I don't remember breakfast, getting dressed, or climbing onto the sled behind my father's snow machine. But I recall a wrist-thick length of twisted rope, coal black against the snow. The line ran through wooden pulleys the size of hubcaps. One end was anchored in a hole drilled through the ice. The other end disappeared into smooth, dark water. Everyone, children, grandparents, men, women, assembled along the rope. Even I, a 4-year-old white kid, more hindrance than help, was allowed to join the line. One, two, three, heave! The line tightened, the pulleys squeaked, heels dug in, forearms burned, people leaned against the weight. Inch by inch we backed up, and a whale emerged, tail first from the sea. When the rope went slack, we all crowded around. Atop the ice lay the animal's full bulk, as long as a bus, taller than a man. Blood seeped from beneath the whale's head. Its massive pink tongue lolled between the comb-like rows of baleen. Images in our family photo album sharpened the hazy edges of my memory. Pictures of men standing on the whale's back, cutting wide slabs of blubber with long-handled knives. Women serving steaming platters of muktuk, strips of black skin and white fat. Smiles and laughter all around. Good fortune, like a warm wind, touched everyone. As a kid, I was ignorant of the deep currents and shifting winds capable of buckling and fracturing the sea ice beneath our feet. I simply trusted the adults to keep me safe. I'll never know who noticed the crack that threatened to set us all adrift, but I'll always remember the celebration swamped by fear. It was a frantic, bumpy ride back to town. Along with my mother and two sisters, I clung to the bucking sled as Dad raced along the rough trail chopped through jumbled ice. I remember two men helping each sled navigate the crest of a steep pressure ridge. When I was pitched from my father's sled, one of those men tossed me in with the next family. Someone caught me, held on, delivered me to solid ground. It's been nearly 50 years since I last experienced the Naluktak, the multi-day party that swept through Uktiagvik following each whale harvest. I can still taste the oily bounce of muktuk and recall the rush of the blanket toss, people thrown impossibly high, arms spinning, backlit by clouds. I can still hear the snap of sticks on skin drums and feel the rhythmic stomp of the dancers' feet. We all, I believe, hunger for such close-knit community. We yearn to pull together with neighbors and celebrate our collective success. So why do we find ourselves living in such rancorous times? How did stories of unity get buried by the din of voices tearing us apart? When did caring for your country become a partisan issue? And by country, I don't mean a flag, song, or pledge, but our actual home ground. The soil, rivers, forest, tundra, air, and climate that make life possible. In the introduction to his book, Tribe, on Homecoming and Belonging, Sebastian Younger writes, "Humans don't mind hardship. In fact, they thrive on it. What they mind is not feeling necessary. As a boy tugging on that whale, I felt, for a moment, a solidarity that stretches back through our evolutionary past." A wealthy person, writes Younger, who has never had to rely on help and resources from his community, is living a privileged life that falls way outside of more than a million years of human experience. Our economy feeds the notion that my well-being is independent of yours. In the belief that no one else will feed you, it's prudent to hoard against starvation. If there's not enough to go around, it makes sense to build walls, to take another's wealth and add it to your own. But no amount of money can bury the truth of our interdependence. Lost in the scramble to build barriers and bank accounts is the richness found in working together. In her book, A Paradise Built in Hell, Rebecca Solnit explores how disasters, both human-made and natural, shatter the patterns that isolate and divide. In towns flattened by winds, in cities leveled by bombs, people emerge from the rubble and become their brother's keeper. in helping each other survive, she writes. They find a purposefulness and connectedness that brings joy even amid death, chaos, fear, and loss. When the ice cracked, my Inupiaq neighbors sought solid ground. But how do we respond to the widening split between economic desire and ecological reality? Where is solid ground when coal plants in Kentucky deepen droughts in Kenya? What's the response when local depletions merge into global extinctions? We cannot bridge the growing gulf between economics and ecology until we see personal well-being as inseparable from the planet's health. We must pull together, expanding the circle of caring beyond immediate family and neighbors. Empathy, the 14th Dalai Lama has said, is the basis of human coexistence. It is my belief that human development relies on cooperation, not competition. So how do we widen empathy to include strangers? How do we swell our affinity for community to include other creatures? Stories. We need better stories. The stories of separation that got us into this mess are not the stories that will get us out. We need stories that illuminate the truth of connections to each other and to this precious blue planet, our only home. We need to reject narratives of division. We need storytellers who blur boundaries, expand empathy, and stretch our capacity for caring. Richard K. Nelson is one such storyteller. And like any good storyteller, he had to first learn to listen. Richard was a keen cultural anthropologist and an astute naturalist. What began as a single winter on the windswept tundra opened into a lifelong journey of listening. For 5 decades, he mushed along frozen rivers, wintered in log cabins, cooked meals over seaside fires. He listened to Inupiaq hunters puzzle over the intricacies of shifting sea ice and migrating caribou. He lived with Koyokan Indians moving through a forest of eyes. He reveled in the whisper of wind through feathers, the scratch of talons on bark, the hiss of rain through trees. And along the way, he took notes, thousands of pages of notes. By candlelight or gas lantern, he wrote each evening until his hand cramped, night after night, year after year. Those notes grew into books, which now line my shelf. His original spiral-bound journals fill boxes jumbled around my desk. The 13,000-plus pages chronicle a transformative journey, a journey through loneliness to a deep sense of home. Throughout this book are entries from many of Richard's journals, which show this transformation, like this passage from his Sitka-based rain journal. There is nothing in me that is not of earth, no split instant of separateness, no moment of existence in which a single particle sets me apart from earth. We have forgotten the most basic and elemental truth of all. Until this truth becomes intuitive again in the Western world, we jeopardize our own existence. Others have not forgotten, and we must go back to them, seeking after lost knowledge. In researching this book, I interviewed dozens of people who have known Richard over the years. Author Barry Lopez was one of them. Before having dinner with Lopez, I read his The Rediscovery of North America, a profound book, small only in its size, It opens in the early hours of October 12, 1492, when Juan Rodriguez Bermeo, aboard the Pinta, spots a dark curve of land rising from the moonlit sea. Bermeo's discovery soon has his sleepy shipmates scurrying on deck as their captain, Cristoforo Colombo, gives orders to reef sails and drift until dawn. "What wealth," Lopez asks, "did Bermeo cry out in anticipation of? Let us be kind, as we hope historians will be kind to us, and say that for him and for many others on those three small ships, perhaps the hummingbird would have been enough. The hummingbird, fresh food after 5 weeks at sea, and the astonishing lives of the Arawak." Sadly, we now know those sailors would not be satisfied by natural marvels and new cultures. This inclusion into the New World, Lopez writes, quickly became a ruthless, angry search for wealth. It set a tone for the Americas. The quest of personal possessions was to be, from the outset, a series of raids, irresponsible and criminal, a spree in which an end to it, the slaves, the timber, the pearls, the fur, the precious ores, and, later, arable land, coal, oil, and iron ore, was never visible, in which an end to it had no meaning. The assumption, Lopez continues, that one is due wealth in North America reverberates in the journals of people on the Oregon Trail. In the public speeches of 19th century industrialists and in 20th century politics. What would have happened, Lopez wonders, if Bermeo and his shipmates had come ashore asking instead, "Who are these people? What is this land?" Stories are born from questions, and the questions we ask matter. They shape how we see the world, and the world is shaped by our vision. 500 years after those ships arrived, a kid from Wisconsin harnessed up a ragtag team of sled dogs, joined a group of Inupiaq hunters, and rediscovered North America. Who are these people? What is this land? Where others had scrounged for gold and would soon drill for oil, Richard K. Nelson mushed across the solid, shifting sea and found his way home. Part 1. Niglik. Center of Gravity. Under the plane's right wing, bright islands of ice floated on a steel-gray sea. Under the left wing, shining puddles and ponds spilled across the flat brown tundra. Shoulder to shoulder with the pilot, a young man in the passenger seat swung his gaze from side to side, mesmerized with his first look at this strange world. The pilot flew with two fingers on the yoke, keeping the single-engine Cessna a mere 100 feet above the beach. The pilot leaned over and shouted above the engine's roar, "First time up this way?"
"Yeah," yelled the young man. "This is fantastic." "Ever seen a caribou?"
"Not yet, but I sure want to."
The plane banked inland and lost altitude. Vivid patterns of water and land flashed by, now only 30 feet below.
"Just ahead," barked the pilot.
Soon they overtook a small herd. The frightened animals ran and swerved. The pilot buzzed a dozen groups, scattering each before lifting the plane away.
"There! Now you've seen 'em!"
"Holy smokes!"
The young man was 22 years old. Still a kid, really. Forehead pressed to the window, he studied the landscape. No trees, no mountains, no buildings, no roads. Just plates of ice, silent and still. Rivers coiled like snakes. A half hour later, a cluster of low buildings slid into view. The plane buzzed the village, and the young man glimpsed his new home, snugged near the coast. The pilot made a sharp seaward turn, right wingtip toward the water, then leveled the plane just above the beach. It hit hard and popped back into the air, bounced twice more, and quickly slowed in the soft black sand. The pilot killed the engine and grinned. The young man's ears rang in the sudden silence.
"Last stop," said the pilot. "Everybody out."
He unbuckled, jumped from the plane, and began unloading the jumble of gear. He handed each parcel to the young man. The young man's features were classically Nordic. Cropped blonde hair and soft blue eyes, bright, even teeth, and a strong, clean jaw. He moved with a liquid grace, his slim frame tuned with strength and balance as he stacked the boxes and duffels in a growing heap. Last to emerge from the plane was a rifle in a cloth case and two long, awkward bundles containing a folding kayak.
"Good luck." The pilot hopped into the cockpit. "Oh, and shield your eyes when I take off."
The engine roared, engulfing the man in wind, sand, and noise. The plane rumbled down the beach, eased aloft, and slipped into the wide gray sky. A stiff breeze off the Arctic Ocean slapped at the young man's blue jeans and coat. A loose box lid rattled. Small waves lapped the black sand. Inland, a steep bluff rose 15 feet above the shore. Atop the bluff, a growing line of people stood motionless, staring down at the stranger. The young man gazed back. It was the last day of August, 1964, in the village of Wainwright, home to 290 Inupiaq Eskimos and 540 sled dogs. The young man was Richard K. Nelson, an anthropology student at the University of Wisconsin in Madison. His parents and older brother knew him as Richard. His high school chums and college buddies referred to him by Nels, or the common nickname, Dick. The Eskimos atop the bluff would soon give him a new name. Richard had no way of knowing the dark days of the coming winter would hold the most lonesome and lovely moments of his life, that the language and lessons, teasing and tenderness, of the men on the bluff would form a gravity around which the rest of his life would bend. He hefted a box of food and trudged toward the line of people. Somewhere a husky yipped, then broke into a howl. Another dog answered. Hundreds of huskies joined in, their combined voices loud against the wind. A dozen children clad in fur parkas clustered where the path crowned onto the flat tundra. Most wore sealskin mukluks. A few had rubber boots.
"What's your name?"
asked the boldest of the boys.
"Dick."
The kids glanced at each other and giggled.
"Dick, Jane, Sally!" exclaimed the bold boy. "Dick, Jane, Sally! Dick, Jane, Sally!"
echoed the others, spiraling themselves into a storm of laughter. Richard flinched, afraid they were making fun of him. Then he realized the joke. To the children, it was as if the main character from the ubiquitous Dick and Jane reading primers had just walked into town.
"What's your name?"
Richard asked the bold boy.
"Norman. Norman Matumyoluk."
"Do you know where the Arctic Research Lab House is?"
"Come on, I'll show you."
Norman led the way to a pale yellow building a few hundred feet from the bluff. Richard stepped through the door into a tight entryway, with just enough room to turn around. Coat hooks poked from the wall. A roll of toilet paper hung from a nail beside a plastic bucket. Richard pushed through the next door and set the box of food on the only table. He stood a moment and let his eyes adjust to the dim light filtering through three small windows. Along the seaward end of the 12-by-20-foot room stood a counter and a small four-burner stove. No sink. Two chairs pulled tight to the table, metal bunks at either side of the door. A single gas lantern hung from the ceiling. When he left for more gear, he approached a small group of adults lingering at the bluff. The women replied to his greetings with a simple, "Hi." The men responded with a slight nod of the head. Richard made over a dozen trips lugging gear from the beach. No one helped. In the following days, temperatures hovered just above freezing. Skies high gray, wind stiff from the northeast. He spent hours wandering the web of muddy paths connecting the small single-story homes scattered about the village. Few had more than one tiny window per wall. All had simple gable roofs and entryways framed out from the doors. Unlike Madison neighborhoods, where all the houses faced the street, the Wainwright homes pointed in all directions, some houses tight together, others alone on the edge of town. Each yard had a half dozen to 20 dogs tethered on short chains. Head-high wooden racks, cobbled together with driftwood and odd boards, kept an assortment of skin boats, seal hides, and caribou legs out of reach of loose animals. Dog sleds awaiting the first snow leaned against buildings or rested on racks. Odd boards, walrus skulls, caribou antlers, garbage sacks, and other debris lay scattered between the homes. People glanced from doorways and yards but kept their distance from the wandering stranger. Richard was grateful when Norman stopped by to invite him ptarmigan hunting. With a .22 rifle slung over his shoulder, Richard's new friend led the way out of town, scampering over uneven tussocks. Aside from knee-high willows bristling from low gullies, the vegetation was no more than ankle-deep. Nothing to break the wind. Richard raised his collar and trudged on, happy for the company of this genial boy so comfortable on the stark tundra. They stopped where the Cook River cut inland, flooding the tundra with a wide lagoon. They watched ducks, geese, and loons swimming just beyond the reach of Norman's gun. When a gull flew over, the boy drew it near with a clucking call. With a single shot, the bird pinwheeled down. "Dog food," Norman explained, holding the gull by its feet. Within a few years, the howl of huskies would be replaced by the whine of snow machines. But in 1964, all overland travel was on foot or on the runners of a dog sled. In the coming months, Richard would learn firsthand anything that swam, walked, or flew was potential food to keep the huskies nourished and pulling. Back in the village, Norman invited him home for dinner. Richard had to bend almost in half to ease through the 2-by-3-foot doorway. Inside, his hair brushed the low ceiling of the cluttered one-room house. A counter of rough boards stretched along a wall beneath a small dust-caked window. A caribou skin-covered bed stood in one corner. In the room's center was a wooden table and two well-used chairs. Norman's radiant, round-faced mother, Lena May, smiled in greeting, her high cheekbones pushing her eyes into narrow slits.
"Azah! You're so tall!" she said.
Richard chuckled. As the smallest kid in his high school, he'd been relentlessly teased about his size. In college, he grew to a respectable 5'10", but still thought of himself as the class runt.
"Sit, sit," Lena May said.
Richard joined Norman at the rough table. Lena May served two chunks of frozen raw caribou and a bowl of stinking amber liquid. Following Norman's lead, Richard picked up a knife and shaved thin strips from the frozen meat, but when Norman dunked the meat into the bowl of putrid fluid, Richard hesitated. Lena May laughed.
"Seal oil. Go ahead. It's good," she said.
Richard dipped some raw caribou, held his breath, and brought it to his mouth. Later, in a letter to his parents, he described the penetrating odor of seal oil.
"It's intense, but I've gotten used to it. Kind of tasteless, actually, like dipping your food in vegetable oil, except for the fermented smell. It was a little bit frightening, but I went ahead. It wasn't bad."
Richard was lucky to have been invited into someone's home so quickly. The people of Wainwright had, in recent decades, grown accustomed to white people coming there to teach and preach. But outside the single school or one of the two churches, a white man's presence was suspect. In another letter, he confided,
"Dear Ma and Pa, I've been having considerable difficulty getting friendly with the adults, who seem pretty unsure about me, and perhaps suspect me of being some kind of fish and game department spy, secret missionary, or something."
Wainwright had one village store, a single room with rough plank flooring and metal shelves half filled with pilot bread, candy, tea, and canned goods. Raymond Aguvluk, the store manager, was the first to flat out ask what Richard was up to. Richard explained the U.S. Air Force wanted a sea ice survival manual for pilots flying missions over the Arctic and the Antarctic. His job was to interview locals, travel on the ice, and send monthly reports to a cold weather survival research facility in Fairbanks. Raymond listened, nodded, and, with hands clasped behind his head, leaned back and said,
"How come they sent you? You don't know nothing."
Buffalo and Bullfrogs. Richard was born on the 1st of December, 1941, in Madison, Wisconsin. Walt Disney had just released the animated film Dumbo. General Mills introduced the breakfast cereal Cheerios. The average price of a new home was $4,150. Gas was 19 cents per gallon. Richard's father, Robert Nelson, managed the Office of Unemployment Compensation for the state of Wisconsin. Florence Nelson was a homemaker. From their house on Outlook Street, Flo and Bob looked across the calm waters of Lake Monona. Wednesday evenings, they bowled in the local city league. Sundays, after the Lutheran service, they tuned their radio to the Green Bay Packers game. In the Nelson house, Jell-O with mini marshmallows was the norm, ketchup an exotic spice. Salad was iceberg lettuce sprinkled with sugar. This was Norman Rockwell's America. This was Leave It to Beaver, brought to life. Flo was just home from the hospital with her newborn when the radio described columns of smoke rising from the ruin of Pearl Harbor. The United States declared war on Japan on the 8th of December. Richard had been alive for a week. Bob was a gentle father and generous neighbor. For years, he came home from work, ate dinner with his family, and then put in an evening shift building batteries to help the war effort. Bob suffered from chronic asthma, and the added hours at the factory stressed his fragile health. His movements were slow, each step judiciously spent. Alongside Bob's cautious pace, Flo whirled with an abundance of nervous energy. Richard was just 3 months old when his mother moved the family out of the house on Outlook Street into a cheaply priced multi-story home across Lake Monona on Few Street. Throughout the war and for years afterward, Flo bought, remodeled, and prettied up house after house at a pace that moved the family through 16 homes in the first 16 years of Richard's life. The home that Richard most remembers the one he wishes had never been sold, was 20 miles east of Madison, in the farming community of Marshall. While Bob commuted into the city, Flo focused her tornado of energy into running a classic small-town store. Nelson's General Store sold it all. Coveralls and motor oil, shovels and bread. The family lived above the store for Richard's fourth and fifth grade years. Richard did well at Marshall Elementary. His report card filled with A's and B's, marred only by a single string of D's in math. Outside of school, he rode along with a neighboring farmer, Jim Herman, as he mowed hay. He also helped Farmer Jim in the barn, hauling feed for the cows and shuttling pails of frothy milk. But more than in the small school and the expansive barn, Richard flourished in the open air. Gripping a fishing pole across the handlebars of his bike, he pedaled off on summer mornings to meet up with friends from surrounding farms. They caught bluegills and crappies in the ponds and lakes. They shucked clothes to skinny dip in the afternoon heat and snuck up on frogs, pounced on snakes. It was a Huck Finn life, always another tree to climb, always a distant patch of woods to explore. The Monisha River flowed lazily behind the house. Richard would have been happy to spend the rest of his childhood fishing those slow waters, but Bob, his asthma growing worse, was tiring of the commute from Marshall, and Flo, itching for the next challenge, sold Nelson's General Store and bought another home near Lake Monona. As his folks shuttled carloads of possessions into town, Richard stayed behind. He spent those final hours on the riverbank, casting into the current. When the time came, he slumped into the back seat and cried all the way to Madison. The curiosity that had thrived in Marshall's open fields shriveled in the cramped halls of East Junior High. A line of D's in English, math, and speech riddled Richard's seventh-grade report card. This dismal performance was in stark contrast to the A's and B's earned by his older brother. Yet Bob and Flo never pressured their younger son to change his ways. "We know you're smart," they said. "We know you could do better if you wanted to." When he wasn't in school, Richard prowled Madison's sloughs and lakeshores in search of turtles and snakes. By the time he enrolled in Monona Grove High, his outside interests had swelled into an obsession. As his classmates did homework, he devoted every scrap of daylight to pursuing creatures wriggling along the edges of ponds and the bottoms of ditches. Anything that scuttled, skittered, or slithered was to be chased, captured, and studied. His parents reluctantly indulged their son's passion, allowing Richard to fill his room with crates, boxes, and tanks to hold his revolving cadre of pets. Naturalist was not part of Richard's boyhood vocabulary. His mom was terrified of snakes. His dad preferred the comfort of the couch over the tangle of the woods. His older brother Dave was more interested in radios than reptiles. But Richard was caught in a current of curiosity he could not escape. The more creatures he found, the harder he looked. Flo eventually parked in the driveway and relinquished the garage to her son's growing array of aquariums and cages. On weekends, Bob drove out of town and sat in the car while his son prowled riverbanks and forest edges for newts and salamanders. Richard appreciated the support, but it would be years before he lived with people who shared his growing interest in the intricacies of the natural world. Out of Richard's flock of friends, Gerald Burgett was the only one who shared his fascination with reptiles. The two made weekly trips to the pet store to buy mice for the hungry snakes. They captured crickets for the frogs, snuck lettuce from the fridge for the turtles, and freshened the bowls of water for the salamanders. When Jerry's family up and moved to Tucson, the boy's obsession spanned the distance. Jerry was soon capturing desert snakes and dryland lizards and mailing them back to his friend in the Midwest. Jerry packed each captive in the hollow center of a chola cactus stick and sealed the ends with newspaper. Richard freed the animals in the bathtub, never sure what would come skittering out. As his collection of critters grew, his interest in school waned. His ninth-grade English teacher, Mrs. Stelter, wrote on the back of his report card, "Richard needs to exercise a little self-control in class." After barely passing him in 10th-grade geometry, Miss Frost wrote, "Richard's grades are very low. In tests, he has had 7, 20, 80, 7, 41, 100, 0, and 0. The perfect score had come the day Richard was sitting behind his math whiz buddy, Pete Bame. Miss Frost separated the boys, and Richard flunked the next two tests. "In the last exam," wrote Miss Frost, "he didn't do a single problem. He seems to be interested only in attracting attention instead of paying attention to the explanation I give in class." Richard wasn't rebelling. He didn't refuse to study. He simply wasn't curious about solving equations or diagramming sentences. He felt bad handing those report cards to his folks, but he also felt powerless to generate interest where none existed. Bob and Flo could have hired a tutor or sent Richard to summer school. They could have made him sit indoors and study until his grades improved. Instead, they sent their son to visit his lizard-loving friend in Arizona. Richard climbed aboard a super constellation, a four-engine plane, for the first flight of his life. After a week of desert adventures, he said goodbye to Jerry in the Tucson train station and settled into a window seat for the long ride home. As the train climbed into the Rockies, he watched the occasional cactus give way to scattered forest. Nothing in glacially scoured Wisconsin had prepared him for the spectacle of Colorado's jagged peaks. He was in high spirits as the train rattled down the foothills and set a straight course across the plains. For years, Richard had combed library shelves for books about critters and plants. He'd repeatedly returned to a book describing the tall grasses swaying across the Great Plains. He wandered through those pages into the convoluted tunnels of prairie dog towns. He imagined the rumbling hooves of bison herds with no end. He heard the sharp cry of red-tailed hawks and the sweet whistle of meadowlarks. He splashed through the shallow waters of prairie rivers, alive with trout and crawdads. Peering from the train, Richard was surprised to find cattle grazing and corn growing tight to the tracks spanning the Colorado lowlands. As the sun set on the sheep and alfalfa of Nebraska, surprise gave way to bewilderment. No one, not the author of his favorite book, nor his parents, teachers, or friends, had ever told Richard the prairie was gone. When the sun rose to reveal endless rows of Iowa corn, bewilderment gave way to heartache. The sorrow over leaving the house in Marshall was tempered by the truth that the house was still there. Although unlikely, it was still possible his parents could change their minds, reopen the Nelson General Store. Still possible he could return to the ponds and fields. The sadness that filled the train car was a new brand of grief. It had no edge, no shore, no way out. Not a single buffalo, no head-high prairie grasses, no chance to return to something no longer there. Richard didn't mention the loss to his parents when the train pulled into Madison. Not a word of it to his friends eager for a game of football. He lived alone with the awareness
of all that was no longer on the Great Plains. For the remaining years of high school, Richard dutifully attended classes, but rarely did the work. As classmates filed forward to hand in homework, he'd sit tight. His poorest grades came in English. After he'd earned 3 D's and an F in a writing course, the teacher, Mrs. Pellet, wrote, "Richard really needs to work on his grammar. He didn't complete several important assignments this quarter. Also, he persists in reading his book, Reptiles, of course, during class, even after many warnings." As soon as he got his license, he borrowed his parents' car and explored on his own. 100 miles out of the city, he followed dirt roads until they dwindled into the weed-choked driveway of an abandoned farm or a boarded-up home. He peered under old planks, snake hook at the ready. He waded creeks and ponds.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.